What's up, y'all? This is Metal Album Reactions, and I'm coming at you today with an actual metal album reaction. So that's kind of cool. This will be the first one I've done in a while. This one comes by special request. I haven't heard this thing before. I don't even know if I've heard anything by this band before, but I have heard of the band. So they are, of course, Winds of Plague. And the album is called The Great Stone War. I haven't even listened to it yet, and I like it already. I like the fact that it's only 39 minutes. I always get annoyed when albums are really long. It just makes it, it becomes a tedious listen, usually, no matter how good the album is. But this one is short. It was released in 2009. The album cover is pretty interesting. It reminds me of some old Warcraft artwork, you know, with the human and the orc facing off like that. It's kind of cool. So, yeah, it says that they're a deathcore band. I don't really listen to much deathcore. I have heard some in my time. Bands like Whitechapel, Job for a Cowboy, Rings of Saturn is probably my favorite deathcore band. But I have to admit, my experience with deathcore is fairly limited. So, yeah, I'm interested to see what this sounds like. This is called The Great Stone War. It's by Winds of Plague. I'm going to get into the first track here. This first track is called Earth. It is 1 minute and 30 seconds.
Earth, home to well over 6 billion people, a most majestic and brilliant sight when seen through the eyes of peace, foreboding to say the least when caught in the gears of the machine, with the world blindfolded by the lust that is laid out for two divine powers to manipulate the pawns into position and to carry out their conquest for global domination. For you see, this world has many mysteries, and nothing is ever what it seems to be. Every action starts with a thought. Every thought comes from an influence. Every influence has its roots. The road is either good or evil, and this is where our story begins.
Yeah, so this is definitely, I would think, a concept album based on that intro track. It sounds like it's setting up the beginning of this epic tale, you know, of war, of conflicting sides upon a battlefield, which is maybe the planet. It sounds very grand. It sounds like it's building up to something. I mean, a lot of albums will do that. They'll have like a short intro to kind of lead into the album. But I like that one. That one was cool. But, you know, the real test of the metal of the album is going to come here in these preceding tracks. I mean, you can have the greatest intro in the world isn't going to make up for you know, songwriting that's lacking or just a bad album. So, but yeah, we'll see how this turns out. This is the second track we're going to go on to. It's called Forged in Fire. It's 3 minutes and 35 seconds. So I'm going to let the whole thing play.
Take off.
I hate to say it, but I hear a little bit of thrash in here, man. Especially that last section, just the way the drum pattern, the drum beat, the drum tempo, and the riffs together, it reminded me of some classic 80s thrash. But I also heard the deathcore in here as well with that interesting, that stop riff that came in around the, I don't know when it was, maybe I'll back it up here. Right here. It's classic deathcore right there. I actually really enjoy the riff writing on this so far. It sounds like, you know, this, if this song's any indication, then I think this is going to show a lot of promise for the album. I like the fact, too, that all of the songs are pretty short. Because, like I've said before, a lot of times in metal, I don't want to say less is more, because I hate that saying. It doesn't make any sense to me. But I'll just say that less is better sometimes. You know, less is better, meaning that, you know, you have so many ideas, you want to fit them into as tight a space as possible, for my money. You don't want any excess fat. Just like if you're writing an essay or a short story or a book or something, you want to trim out the fat. You want to just submit something that is just good stuff. You know, none of the mediocre excess stuff. So, yeah, but so far, I have to say, yeah, the riff writing on this is really good. It's heavy. It's got influences from thrash, deathcore, death metal. It all seems to be mixed in there. Vocals sound good. Everything sounds good. So I'm going to go ahead and let it play out. Cue the mosh pit at the very end there. The thing about deathcore, I will say, is deathcore, the way the riffs are in the music and the way the songs are structured a lot of times, it makes it very obvious when you as a listener are supposed to get excited, when you're supposed to mosh, when you're supposed to freak out and just go berserk. Like they always, a lot of them, I've noticed in various deathcore songs, there'll be like a big pause or some kind of like build-up or a pause, and then there'll be some kind of breakdown. And you found one of those at the end of this song. So we're definitely dealing with a deathcore album here. With that said, like I've said before, I'm not really a huge fan of deathcore, but I do like a lot of the riffs on that song were just good, man. They were heavy, they were dark, they were evil, they were definitely blood pumping, and I think they did a really good job on that song, just keeping it interesting, keeping it varied. And even though there were some aspects of the song that were very traditional deathcore, I mean, I felt like there was it was mixed in with enough other influences to keep the music interesting and not get stale or bland. So yeah, I like that second song, Forged in Fire, pretty well. I'm gonna get on to this third track. This is called Soldiers of Doomsday. It is 4 minutes and 6 seconds, so yeah, I'm going to stop it in the middle here.
Hey.
I like the main riff in this song, and the way the song started, at least from the guitarist standpoint, it sounded almost like something you would find in like technical death metal, something that maybe Wretched would have written. It was a very, very cool riff there. And I have to say, too, that when it comes to riff writing, like, a lot of these death metal bands, they can tend to get stuck. When you talk about the riff writing, they can get stuck on maybe three or four different chords or just positions on the fretboard, like the lower end strings towards the headstock. They can get stuck on just a few different chords up there, a few ideas, and you end up hearing a lot of the same chords used over and over and over and over again. But riffs like that, it seems like there's a lot more melodic movement, you know, in the actual chord, the actual riff itself. It seems like there's a lot of there's more of a variance or a range of what's actually being played. Or maybe it's just the fact that it's not a traditional, you know, death metal riff or a traditional thrash riff that makes it interesting to me. I'm not sure. But did you guys catch that? Again, we got the breakdown. We got the stop riff again. So I don't know if it's going to be on every single song. I think it's cool. But I think in deathcore they may overuse that just a little bit. I think it's supposed to be like the heaviest thing that they can think of. They're like, yeah, we just need to put some space in between these notes or these chords and time it with the person who's headbanging, have the drums and the guitar in perfect sync with one another, and just have these kind of like jolting, stuttering sort of sections that are really just designed to get people to mosh. I think that's what the intent is behind it, but... And it's cool. Whenever I listen to a band, if there's a singular idea that they're using that works, even if it works, I don't want them to return to it too often, because then it starts to get a little bit predictable and a little bit, it loses some of its novelty, we'll just say. So I think deathcore bands are guilty of using that type of riff a little bit too much. We've seen it on a couple songs here already, but it sounds good. I mean, this song is... I probably like this song better than the one that preceded it. I think this song is great. Let's see how they go ahead and finish it out. The introduction of the keyboard on that track, I think it kind of added a little bit of flavor to a sound that can get very monotonous very quickly. Not deathcore, I mean, but just death metal period. You know, it can get a little bit samey, and sometimes it helps for bands to introduce a little bit of that exotic instrumentation just to add a different profile to the sound. And I think they did a good job on that track. You guys notice that the tempo switched up very, very close to the end there. And, you know, you will know the tempo. If you are headbanging and you get into the same groove of headbanging the same way throughout the entire song at the same pace, then you'll know that probably the tempo is staying relatively the same or staying very consistent. But if all of a sudden it changes up, you find yourself moving differently, your body starts to move differently, then you can almost bet that there was some kind of pattern change as far as what the drummer is doing, the tempo, the pace, all that's probably changed significantly. And that's what happened near the end of that track. That was kind of cool. That's what I look for when I look at death metal. Of course, there's always the riffs. Are they memorable? Are they intricate? Are they beautiful in a certain way, right? Are they badass? We'll just say that. But outside of the guitar work and the riff writing and the solos and all that stuff, you know, is the drummer keeping things interesting and flowing and moving by changing tempos? You know, we've got to have some various different tempos throughout a track to make it feel and seem like there's actual progression happening in the music. If you listen to an album, an extreme metal album, and the tempo stays relatively consistent or the same throughout the whole thing, then, man, it's going to get pretty lame and boring pretty quickly. So I think this band is doing a very good job of that so far. I think they're doing a good job keeping the tempo and all of that pretty varied. So that's good. It's going to make it a more fun listen for me as I go through the album. And speaking of that, we're going to move on to track 4. This is called Approach the Podium, and it is 3 minutes and 39 seconds. Something about a very well executed palm muted riff, you know, in heavy music, in death metal and thrash metal. You don't find it as much in black metal, but I just love those kind of quick stuttering, those very choppy sort of palm muted riffs. When you get those in sync with the drums in like a certain way, it just sounds so cool. I love that. And then I have to say, this song is super heavy. This is probably the heaviest song that they've had so far on the album, and it sounds great. I mean, again, the tempo's changed a few times. It sounds good. It's keeping my interest. It's holding my interest, but it's just heavy. I mean, this song is so far is probably this one, the last one. They've all three been good so far, all three of the songs. But this one to me feels a little bit special, just because the way it started out with that kind of classic, you know, Americana, almost like country western, but it wasn't country western. But you know, get what I'm saying. It's that sort of that front porch playing. That's that sort of guitar that comes like it. That's, you know, generations old that people have been doing for a long, long time, and they kind of just burst right in with these huge power chords. Then they had the palm muted riff. and they got your head banging at different tempos. And I think they've done a great job with this song so far. There's a lot of different ideas in here, and that's what you want to see and hear when you talk about heavy music. So, yeah, we're going to go ahead and let the rest of the song play out. I think the way that the keyboard is being worked into this music, it reminds me almost of some of the symphonic black metal that I've heard. You know, some of the bands like Dimmu Borgir, for example, or just black metal in general, like Cradle of Filth, even though people argue they're not really a black metal band. I think they were when they started out. They kind of evolved into this gothic thing, but or maybe they were always gothic. They just phased out the black metal portion of their music as they got older, but this reminds me of something I would have heard off Cradle of Filth or Dimmu or maybe some Arcturus. You know, just having that worked in there, it's so different, man. It's definitely, because this could have been a very monotonous listen, okay? Like I've said before, you have a certain sound profile, and that's what a genre really is. If you think about it, it's just a sound profile. You have a certain sound profile, you have various components and elements of that profile. You could execute that profile, and it would fit squarely within a certain genre of music. But when you start adding other elements, other instruments, other ideas to that existing profile, you create something different. You may not create something completely different, but you'll definitely spice up the soup a little bit, if that makes sense. So, yeah, I'm glad that that's in here. And so far, I'm pretty impressed with everything that I've heard so far on this album. I think that, you know, the guitarists are really talented. Yeah, they may use the stop riff a lot, but I think that's pretty... it's to be expected with a deathcore band. I like the fact that there's keyboard in here. The vocals, kind of hit or miss on the vocals. I think the low gutturals do sound really good, however. But so far, I think the songs have been written really well. I think the guitar playing is fantastic, and it's super heavy, and, you know, it's brutal, but at the same time, it's melodic. It's got a lot of things going for it, so I'm pretty happy. We're going to move on to the fifth track. This is called Battle Scars, and it is 3 minutes and 25 seconds.
Thank you.
can see why the person that recommended this to me likes this. It's very melodic. There's a lot of Paul muted riffage all over the place. The solo in this song was actually very cool. I love that guitar tone that he's using. Very clean, smooth, sweet. This is probably the most melodic song that we've heard so far. And that's a cool, that's a good thing. I mean, in especially in death metal, I think that sometimes we sacrifice melody for the sake of brutality. Like, we want to be amelodic, you know, to a degree. And I think because of that, I mean, we've got an almost entire genres where melody's almost been completely eliminated. If you look at brutal death metal, for example, a lot of those bands, you know, Cryptopsy, Dying Fetus, you know, at least Dying Fetus's earlier stuff, Suffocation, I mean, you don't find a lot of melody in those songs. And it's cool for what it is, but at the same time, I think that, you know, actually, you know, really good death metal, my favorite death metal is the stuff that blends melody, ferocity, and brutality, and technicality. You know, it's got all of these different things. So this is checking a lot of those boxes for me. So even though it's deathcore, I mean, this has got, it's technical. You know, it sounds like it would be difficult to play. I love, obviously, the melodies in this song are fantastic. It's brutal. It's just checking a lot of those boxes, like I said. And I want to say, too, that a guitar player, like when you talk about a metal guitar player, a lot of what makes those guys who they are, people can talk about all sorts of different things. They're different techniques and their basic chops and how good are they on their instrument, like how, or you know, how creative they are, or various different things. But really, for me, it's like these guys, these guitar players, in order to be at that next level or to be an elite metal guitar player, it's all about writing melodies that stick. Okay, so if that's the case, then you're not going to find the most interesting, fascinating guitar work in genres like brutal death metal. It's just not going to be there. I mean, you're going to find stuff really that's on the more melodic side of things. That's where you're going to find a lot of the more impressive guitar playing. Can these guys create, invent melodies that are memorable and that stick and that work within the context of a song to make the song great? I mean, it is what it is. You guys can feel free, by the way, if you disagree with anything that I'm saying, go ahead and argue with me down in the comment section. I welcome, you know, healthy debate surrounding some of these topics. I just think that, you know, a guitar player who can't write a melody is not worth his salt, you know, even when we talk about extreme metal guitar players. So, yeah, that's what we're working with right now. This is good shit. I'm going to go ahead and finish the rest of this song out. Some cool classical guitar to close that track out. That might be the best song on the album so far. This album just feels like it's getting better and better and better. I mean, I've liked every single song on here. I've liked better than the previous song. That goes for Soldiers of Doomsday, Approach the Podium, Battle Scars. I feel like the album just keeps getting better and better. So, this is where I get to this point, and usually when I'm listening to albums in their entirety, I get to a point like this where I'm like, man, how many good songs are there going to be on this album? How many good are we going to get in a row? You know, usually what I've noticed, bands usually are able to put together on a great album or, you know, a good album, really good album, they'll usually find something like 5 or 6 or 7 stellar tracks in a row. That's usually like the limit. And then you'll have a few tracks that you don't really care for. It's like that on most albums. There's very few albums that I could think that I've ever heard in the history of my listening to heavy metal where I've thought that every single song on the album was just fantastic. And I could just, you know, I just thought the whole thing was stellar, you know, no weak songs or anything like that. Usually, even on some of my favorite albums, you'll hit a streak of about 5 or 6, and then you'll have a couple that you don't like, and then a lot of times the album will recover, come back with some songs that you do like, and it kind of goes like that. So far we've got the intro Earth, and then 4 tracks in a row here that I really like. I'm curious to see how much longer this can sustain itself. So we're going to go ahead and see. We've got, this is track 6. It's called Chest and Horns. It is 4 minutes long. Okay, I've been meaning to say this for a few songs now, but it's been there slightly, and I haven't really, come out with it just because I've been, taking the wait-and-see approach. Let's just wait and see. Let's not tag it until it becomes a major aspect of the music. So, yeah, there's a definite Middle Eastern influence on this album. I don't know where that's coming from. I don't know where Winds of Plague is from. I mean, there are some passages on this album that sound like they could have been written by a band like Nile or Melechesh, or, you know, something that's got a little bit of a Middle Eastern or Sumerian influence. And that's really cool. I like that. I don't know why that seems to go so well together with death metal or with deathcore in this case, but it just works, man. If you use those scales in that context, man, it just sounds badass. I love, there's a section on here that I just freaking love. Like, this is my favorite type of riff that they have written on this album so far. Definitely a holdover from melodic death metal, I must say. But yeah, I love stuff like that. It's heavy, but it's not chuggy. You know, sometimes I get a little bit bored with stuff that's real chuggy and just real like, we're gonna just hammer some chords out in front of you, you know? That kind of, sometimes I like the stuff that sounds a little bit more melodic, a little bit more technical, like I've already mentioned in this reaction. For me, that type of riff, that definitely qualifies. And like I said, to me, it seems like it's borrowed a little bit from some of the Gothenburg stuff, you know, At the Gates, Dark Tranquillity and Flames. It seems like it's borrowed from that style, but hey, it sounds good to me, so who really cares where it's borrowed from, right? But yeah, we're gonna go ahead and finish this song. This is another good song, I have to say, man. I'm impressed. This album's definitely going for a very epic vibe. You know, it's trying to be epic. It's trying to be majestic. It's trying to tell a story of an epic battle between two conflicting forces. I'm assuming they're good and evil, but I don't really know. I haven't read the lyrics of the song, so. But it's based on the album cover, based on the intro, and just, you know, the song titles, and it sounds like. Yeah, this is telling an epic tale of history, and I'm not sure if these more symphonic intros and outros in the music, if these are sort of conventional at this point when you talk about genres like deathcore. Like, I haven't listened to enough deathcore to know if what this band is doing on this album is something to be expected or if it appears on a lot of different deathcore albums. I mean, as far as the symphonic aspect of the music, but. It's cool, man. It definitely distinguishes the album. It makes it a little bit more unique. And yeah, I'm very impressed so far. That song, I thought that song was really good. I don't know if I like it as much as Battle Scars and Approach the Podium. I might even like Soldiers of Doomsday more, but this is definitely a good song. I think it would fit right above Forged in Fire. And I mean, they're all good. I haven't heard a bad song on this album yet, so I'm really just nitpicking here. But yeah, we're gonna go ahead and move on to the seventh track. This is called Creed of Tyrants, and it is 2 minutes and 45 seconds.
Yeah.
this is cool, but I will say a couple of things about this. The first thing is that there was this part in the earlier part of the song. Right here. Okay. From about 9 seconds to 17 seconds. Really cool keyboard slash piano part there. Really kind of, I don't know, dark, kind of melodic. Not melodic, dark, melancholic. And a melody there. And then you had the, what sounded like strings, and they were kind of climbing. They had this sort of ascending quality. And there was a melodic theme there. They're built into that section. You know, I feel like for this band to have inserted that into the song and then to have abandoned that melodic theme so quickly when the distorted guitar and the drums and the rest of the music came back in, it's just such a shame. It's almost like, you know, I don't really understand why they would have inserted that into the music, except to create contrast maybe between that sound and the typical sound of the song, and maybe just to break things up. But the thing is that, like I said before, like, there was a definite melodic theme that was present in that section from about 9 to 17 seconds, just with those two elements, just with the keyboard or the piano and what sounded like the strings. I mean, they could have taken that melodic theme and could have stretched it out and applied it and used it to write an entire song. And they maybe could have approached it differently with the heavier instruments, and with the guitars and with the bass and the drums. They could have approached it from that aspect. But I think it would have been really cool to see them carry that throughout an entire song and throughout the rest of this song, because I think it would have made for an interesting song. I really like that. So, yeah, I'm just a little bit miffed that they kind of abandoned that so quickly. Because the rest of this sounds very similar to what we've already gotten on the album. And that's my next thing I wanted to talk about, is just that, you know, I like this style. I like what they're doing. I like the guitar riffing and all that stuff. But just, for example, I'll play a little bit of it for you here. It just sounds very similar to what we've already heard on the album, and I know there's going to be consistency throughout an album where, you know, you're hearing things presented to you, especially in the realms of death metal and deathcore and its other variants. You're going to be hearing, you know, the same approach over and over and over again, usually, throughout the course of an album. It just, at this point, I think I'm kind of looking for them to maybe take it in a little bit of a different direction, to kind of see maybe if they can pull some other things off. If instead of writing these really similar riffs and having them in every song, if maybe they can, experiment's the wrong word, but if maybe they can just try to approach it a little bit differently. Just, you know, they've had a lot of songs that sound like the riffs are borrowed from melodic death metal. You know, maybe they could incorporate something from that leans a little bit more on thrash. As far as in the riff writing, maybe they could incorporate something that sounds a little bit more blackish, from a little bit more black metal. You know, maybe they could have something that's real slow, dirgy, and just heavy, like go into the doom or funeral doom kind of area. Not completely, but just borrow maybe a little bit of those ideas as far as writing, the riff writing is concerned. So that's all I'm really thinking of when I'm hearing this. It still sounds good. It's just that, you know, I'm at the 7th track. You know, I've heard that a little bit on this album already. And yeah, I just would like to see maybe bands in the future maybe think about that when they're composing an entire album. Just realize that your listener, you know, you want to keep presenting fresh ideas so that the listening experience doesn't get stale or predictable. And predictable is really the key word. If the listener feels like they can click on one of your songs, and before they've even heard it, if they feel like they know what to expect, and that's usually the death knell for, you know, an interesting, adventure-filled, captivating listening experience. Usually, there's got to be a little bit of freshness there, is what I'm saying. So anyway, I think I've hammered this point home enough. I'm going to go ahead and let the rest of the song finish out. That was a great song. Like I said, at this point on the album, we're getting towards we're about to hit track 8, and there's 12 on the album. So we're about two-thirds the way through it. And yeah, at this point in an album, I always look to see, you know, where are the duds at, you know, because there's usually always duds on an album. Are they at the front, or are they in the middle somewhere buried, or are they at the end, or what's going to happen? I'm thinking about that, but I'm also thinking, you know, is this band going to get stuck? Are they going to get stuck in this, doing the same approach, the same formula every time? You know, are they willing to, at a certain point in the album, to start introducing some new and fresh ideas just to keep the music interesting? Because most people, they don't listen to a full album, so they never have this complaint. They cherry-pick songs, individual songs, and then they find a song they like, and they just listen to that song over and over and over and over again. But for people like me that like to listen to the whole thing, I kind of like to see, just like if you watch a movie, you know, if you watch a movie, you want a plot that's, number one, always moving forward, that doesn't get stale or stagnant, but you also want a plot that two-thirds of the way through you don't get bored. You know, you want a plot that's continually introducing new elements, having you consider things from different angles, new perspectives. Maybe there's new characters are coming in, maybe new themes are developing, just something to kind of keep the story from growing stale, you know. That's kind of what I look for when I listen to an album. I don't just want to hear the same approach for 50 minutes, you know. I want to hear some variation there. So we'll see if they can muster something up here. These remaining, I guess we've got 5 tracks remaining. This next one is called Our Requiem, and it is 4 minutes and 14 seconds.
Yeah.
the record, all the solos on this album have been really good, man. These guys are definitely talented. I didn't know if I was going to like this song, just because it was a little bit too symphonic for my tastes. Right around here is when I started to get back into the song. You know, I just criticized them for not throwing in any variations, and I think they did on this track. I think this track, the way it started, in fact, they really stuck true to the symphonic theme that they started the track out with. And, you know, they were doing a good job of keeping with that theme through the majority of the first third of this track. That's just not usually something that, when I listen to, like, extreme metal that I really care too much for. But, I mean, it is what it is. I think at least with this song, it sounds like they tried something a little bit different, and that's good. That's exactly what I was talking about, because this is exactly about the point in the album you get to, usually, where the band's initial approach starts to get a little bit stale. So, yeah, they definitely did a good job with that. Yeah, this song's pretty good. I don't know if I would place it necessarily on the same level as some of the other songs I've heard. I think the first, excluding the intro track, I think the first five that I heard, everything from Forged in Fire to Chest and Horns, I think I really, really loved all of that. Creed of Tyrants was pretty good, too. This one, I don't know where I would put this one, maybe probably underneath some of those other ones, but this is still pretty cool, though. This is showing some promise here. Again, I really like the solo in this song. I thought that guitar tone is just killer, man. When you talk about solos, yeah, it sounds really, really clean, really good. Yeah, this sounds like it. I mean, with this band, they've already introduced a lot of different ideas on this album, which is a good thing. I mean, they could go in a lot of different directions in the last 2 minutes here, so we're going to see what's going on with this. Okay, so, yeah, that last track, Our Requiem, I kind of was conflicted on that one. I liked the last two-thirds of the track. Specifically, I wanted to talk about this right here. Yeah, You know, I think that they could also benefit maybe from inserting more of those passages into the songs. At the risk of sounding too proggy, I mean, I think they could get away with that a little bit more. Some of those sections where it's not as quite a solo, I wouldn't really call it a solo, but it just sounds like the guitar player is noodling just a little bit. You don't want to have an entire album of that, but every now and again, man, if you can put that in there and, you know, as long as it's not too tedious, I think it could actually bring a track to life and make it that much more interesting, because I like stuff like that. So, yeah, I like that part of the track. You know, I criticized this band for abandoning, you know, a melodic theme that they had already established early on in the song. I can't remember. I think it was on the Creed of Tyrants. This song, it seemed like they stuck true to the original theme or the original melody, the symphonic thing. But I felt like the symphonic aspect of the music was maybe dominating the track a little bit. And it felt like that for about the first third of the track. And for me, that was a little bit too much. It's really tough, because sometimes I'll like a band like Septic Flesh, for example, and that's basically symphonic death metal. Sometimes I'll like stuff like that. I know I've liked other bands like Dimmu Borgir in the past that have a heavy symphonic influence. To me, it's a very delicate situation, because when it's done right, then it could be epic. You know, it could be like, to me, it's like some of the best stuff that you can create. You know, it's got that symphonic overtone, or it's powered by that symphonic approach, that sound. But other times, I think it can, and I thought this about the last Septic Flesh album that I listened to, the last one that came out anyway, the Codex Omega. I'm pretty picky when it comes to that kind of thing. I didn't think this was a bad song. I think they, for me anyway, listening to it, it sounded like they definitely came around like the last half or last two-thirds of this track, so I did end up liking it pretty well. But yeah, with the symphonic stuff, man, there's a fine line between just enough and too much. You know, sometimes it can just get really overbearing, that kind of thing, so... But anyway, we're going to go ahead and move on to this ninth track. This is called Classic Struggle. It is 3 minutes and 20 seconds. Yeah, it sounds like this album's getting more and more symphonic the further it goes along, which is a good thing. But like I've said already, I think that for me what separates songs that have that influence that I really enjoy to songs that are just a little bit too much that I just won't go there, I don't listen to it as much. I think in extreme metal, when the symphonic element provides an interesting backdrop to the actual metal instrumentation, I think it could work very well. Or if it's maybe one of many different elements or components in the music. Like, for example, if a band wanted to use a violin in their music, I mean, that's typically an orchestral instrument, but if it's worked in, if it's just one of the many different instruments that they use and one component of the music, then it can work really, really well, in my opinion. If a band has a synthesizer or a keyboard, if the actual sound of that instrument is providing sort of like an overlay or a backdrop to the music, I think it can be very, very effective. You hear that in a lot of different bands, especially a lot of doom bands. They like to do that. Use synthesizers to sort of set a mood with the music. But the thing is, and in prog, you hear a lot of keyboard, right? And keyboard can kind of be a secondary instrument to the guitar. It can be inserted at different spots. It can solo. It can provide melodic support, do all these different things. But for me, when any of those instruments, any of those different sounds, begins to become the central focus of the music, that's sort of where my interest begins to wane when it comes to extreme metal or just metal in general. At the end of the day, for me, I think I like to have those basic sort of traditional conventional instruments be the central focus and point of the music. And then if you want to supplement those with other sounds, then that's okay. Sometimes it can be great, you know, fantastic or whatever, but I think whenever some of those secondary sounds or those supplemental instruments, whenever they begin to dominate and take up the center stage in the music, or they just become too overpowering, I think it sort of detracts from the music, in my opinion. That's when you talk about metal anyway. So I think in this song, it's actually being pulled off pretty well. So, but everybody's going to have their different opinions as far as what's too much or what isn't enough or, you know, what sounds good and what doesn't. But just for my ear, it sounds like in this song there, that symphonic element's definitely present. It's definitely being given its moment of shine. It's providing a theme for the song. It's providing the backdrop to what's happening. But to me, at least in this song, it doesn't sound like it's completely overpowering the song. So that's why I like it. But I'm going to go ahead and move on. Or I guess not move on just yet. I'm going to go ahead and play the rest of this song. Towards the end, it started to be a little bit too much for me. What to say about that song, man? I think that song had a lot of good strengths. I think the guitar playing was fantastic. For a while, I was on board with the symphonic elements of the song. I thought they were being incorporated well, to where it wasn't too much. I think at the end there, it did get to be a little bit overwhelming for me, a little bit overpowering. But you know, overall, it was a good song. I think that is the first really good song. The album was going really, really well. I think Creed of Tyrants and Our Requiem, those two songs were a little bit rocky for me. But this last song, I thought, was the first one that is like, now we're back on track. You know, I think that, again, it sounds like this album's getting more and more symphonic the further it goes along. So we'll see if they maintain it at the level it's at, if they ratchet it up a little bit more, or if it dips down a little bit. I'm not sure what's going to happen, but yeah, I like it. I like it so far. I'm not opposed to symphonic metal or to symphonic bands or bands that incorporate symphonic elements. Not at all. It's just it has to... I'm very, very picky when it comes to that stuff. It has to be done in, like, at the right... in the right amount, you know, so that it doesn't completely overpower the metal, you know. That's it. So I want to go ahead and move on to this 10th track, The Great Stone War. This is the title track, and it is 4 minutes and 17 seconds. Great. This is how I want the symphonic. I keep harping on this point, but this is how I want it done, man. They're reining it in, you know. It's present in the music, but it's not dominating. And that's refreshing, you know. This sounds really good. This is heavy. I love that guitar tone. The opening sounded like, when the guitars came in, it sounded like some old school Sepultura or something. Sounded really cool. I like that. I like a lot of things about this song so far. It's just... This band, this album, this is head-bobbing, head-banging music right here, man. This is stuff that it so easily lends itself to moving your body. It's like, it's just amazing how bands can write music like this that's so, it's so mosh-ready. You know, it's this is ready for the stage, ready for a sold-out venue, ready for a pit full of angsty teenagers and 20-year-olds, you know, to get behind this and fucking just bang the fuck out of their heads. This is like, I mean, what can you say, man? This is really, really good. I'm really glad that this band, aside from being just a pure deathcore band, has a lot of other influences in their music. Like I've said, it makes it a more palatable listen for me. And so far, if this is going to be the title track, then I'd be pretty happy with that. I think this is a good track. So I'm going to go ahead and let it finish the rest of the way out.
Yeah.
They did the same thing again at the end of the song that they did on one of the other songs. They got all the way to the end of the song, and then they had this kind of build up, and then this brief pause, and then this huge breakdown. Well, I'll play it for you again. Hold on. Ideas like that are great, but they get old really quick. It's like you've got to, like, they've only done it a couple times on this album. That's good, but man, I could shudder to think if they had tried to use that in every single song on this thing, man, it would have got old. I think that is pretty classic when you talk about deathcore, but it is what it is. I think it's cool, and I understand what they're trying to do, and I don't knock them for it. They're trying to make music that's heavy. You know, that's what that technique is for. It's the breakdown. That's what the purpose is, just to make music that sounds really heavy, and I want music that's heavy too. Like, I'm totally on board with these guys. I agree with them. That's what I want. It's just that it's such an obvious build-up. It's like a twist in a movie that you see coming 30 minutes or 45 minutes before it actually comes. You know, when the twist finally happens, if you saw it all along what it was going to be, if you anticipated it, it doesn't have any effect, you know? And with something like that, I think that's so obvious in the way it's made and the way it's built, it's really difficult to have to receive the same impact that I'm sure was intended whenever that was written. So, you know, I'm not going to knock them for having it on the album. I'm really glad that they didn't put something like that in every single song, because, man, and I'm sure there are deathcore albums out there that are like that. You know, it would have made it a tough listen, you know. Every time you heard it, you would have been like, oh, really, again, you know? So, but, anyway, great song. So that song, I thought that song was one of the best on the whole album. Definitely worthy of being the title track. I mean, that it was chuggy as fuck. Not as melodic as some of the other songs, but again, that's a welcomed relief and break from what they've been doing. To me, that song sounded like it borrowed a lot more from just straight death metal. And yeah, that's really cool to hear on here. So I think this band, like I said, I think they are doing enough to keep this thing varied and interesting. And so that's a relief for me as a listener, because there's nothing worse than getting stuck in the middle of an album and you've got, you know, 30 minutes of music left and you know what it's going to sound like. I mean, that's the worst feeling in the world. So yeah, we're going to go ahead. Loved that track. We're going to go ahead and move to track 11. This is called Tides of Change. It's 2 minutes and 25 seconds. Now, that right there was the true closer on the album. So there's another track after that called Halloween, and it's by The Misfits. It's a cover, I'm assuming. So I'm not going to bother with that. That, what I just heard, Tides of Change, that is the true outro or finishing song on this album. So just the way that sounded, the way the intro sounded, it sounds like this was a very cohesive, tight, well-constructed, at least on the surface, from a thematic standpoint. This was a very cohesive album. I don't know if it was a concept album, per se. I wouldn't know that from not reading the lyrics. But just the way the album was structured, with The Great Stone War, the title track, being the second-to-last track, and then having the outro, it definitely sounds like this was a very well thought out, very cohesive body of music, you know. So this is, gotta give it up to Winds of Plague, man. And if this is, you know, deathcore, an example of a deathcore band, I think it is. And if this is a deathcore album, then I would definitely be in support of this, because this wasn't, you know, meat and potatoes deathcore as far as what I've heard from other bands. I mean, this had influences from thrash, death metal, melodic death metal, had influences from symphonic metal. I mean, this thing had a lot to it. There was a lot going on in this album. And yeah, I do think that right around the seventh track, Creed of Tyrants, right to that point, I felt like it was starting to get a little bit formulaic. But I think these last four tracks, they ratcheted up the symphonic elements of the music to their detriment at some points. I think it was a little bit too much at different points, but overall I think they did a really good job with that in order to keep the album interesting, you know, and to keep presenting new sounds and new ideas. Overall, I thought this was a fantastic album, and I'm glad I listened to it. This definitely opens my eyes and gets me interested in a little bit more of the deathcore style, because if there are other bands in that genre that can present a product that's as varied and as interesting as this, and it still be brutal, but also melodic at different points, and to have some clear influences from other genres mixed in there with some of the traditional elements of deathcore, I think that I'd be interested in hearing more of that music. So yeah, this was really cool. I'm really glad I got to listen to this thing. Guys, if you enjoyed the video, be sure to like, comment, subscribe below. Let me know what you'd like to see me react to or review in the future. This is Metal Album Reactions. I hope you're having a good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night. And I will see you guys in the next video. Peace.